Chapter 1. Neanderthal Ex Machina. Late one night in 1996, just as I had dozed off in bed, my phone rang. The caller was Matthias Krings, a graduate student in my laboratory at the Zoological Institute of the University of Munich. All he said was, "It's not human." "I'm coming," I mumbled, threw on some clothes, and drove across town to the lab. That afternoon, Matthias had started our DNA sequencing machines, feeding them fragments of DNA he had extracted and amplified from a small piece of a Neanderthal arm bone held at the Rheinisches Landesmuseum in Bonn. Years of mostly disappointing results had taught me to keep my expectation low. In all probability, whatever we had extracted was bacterial or human DNA that had infiltrated the bone sometime in the 140 years since it had been unearthed. But on the phone, Matthias had sounded excited. Could he have retrieved genetic material from a Neanderthal? It seemed too much to hope for. In the lab, I found Matthias along with Ralph Schmitz, a young archaeologist who had helped us get permission to remove the small section of arm bone from the Neanderthal fossil stored in Bonn. They could hardly control their delight as they showed me the string of A's, C's, G's, and T's coming out of one of the sequencers. Neither they nor I had ever seen anything like it before. What to the uninitiated may seem a random sequence of four letters is in fact shorthand for the chemical structure of DNA, the genetic material stored in almost every cell in the body. The two strands of the famous double helix of DNA are made up of units containing the nucleotides adenine, thymine, guanine, and cytosine, abbreviated A, T, G, and C. The order in which these nucleotides occur makes up the genetic information necessary to form our body and support its functions. The particular piece of DNA we were looking at was part of the mitochondrial genome, mtDNA for short, that is transmitted in the egg cells of all mothers to their children. Several hundred copies of it are stored in the mitochondria, tiny structures in the cells, and it specifies information necessary for these structures to fulfill their function of producing energy. Each of us carries only one type of mtDNA, which comprises a mere 0.0005% of our genome. Since we carry, in each cell, many thousands of copies of just the one type, it is particularly easy to study, unlike the rest of our DNA, a mere two copies of which are stored in the cell nucleus, one from our mother and one from our father. By 1996, mtDNA sequences had been studied in thousands of humans from around the world. These sequences would typically be compared to the first determined human mtDNA sequence, and this common reference sequence, in turn, could be used to compile a list of which differences were seen at which positions. What excited us was that the sequence we had determined from the Neanderthal bone contained changes that had not been seen in any of those thousands of humans. I could hardly believe that what we were looking at was real. As I always am when faced with an exciting or unexpected result, I was soon plagued by doubts. I looked for any possibility that what we saw could be wrong. Perhaps someone had used glue produced from cowhide to treat the bones at some point, and we were seeing mtDNA from a cow. No, we immediately checked cow mtDNA, which others had already sequenced, and found that it was very different. This new mtDNA sequence was clearly close to the human sequences, yet it was slightly different from all of them. I began to believe that this was, indeed, the first piece of DNA ever extracted and sequenced from an extinct form of human. We opened a bottle of champagne kept in a fridge in the lab's coffee room. We knew that if what we were seeing was really Neanderthal DNA, enormous possibilities had opened up. It might one day be possible to compare whole genes, or any specific gene, in Neanderthals to the corresponding genes in people alive today. As I walked back home through a dark and quiet Munich, I'd had too much champagne to drive, I could hardly believe what had happened. Back in bed, I couldn't sleep. I kept thinking about Neanderthals and about the specimen whose mtDNA, it seemed, we had just captured. In 1856, 3 years before the publication of Darwin's The Origin of Species, workers clearing out a small cave in a quarry in Neander Valley, about 7 miles east of Dusseldorf, uncovered the top of a skull and some bones they thought had come from a bear. But within a few years, the remains were identified as those of an extinct, perhaps ancestral, form of human. This was the first time that such remains had been described, and the finding shook the world of naturalists. Over the years, research has continued on those bones and many more like them since found, seeking to discern who the Neanderthals were, how they lived, why they disappeared some 30,000 years ago, how our modern ancestors interacted with them over thousands of years of coexistence in Europe, and whether they were friend or foe, our forebears, or simply our long-lost cousins. See Figure 1.1. Tantalizing hints of behaviors familiar to us, such as care of the injured, ritualistic burial, and maybe even the production of music, emerged from archaeological sites, telling us that the Neanderthals were much more like us than is any living ape. How alike? Whether they could speak, whether they were a dead-end branch of the hominin family tree, or whether some of their genes are hidden in us today, are all questions that have become an integral part of paleoanthropology, the academic discipline that can be said to have started with the discovery of those bones in Neander Valley, from which we now seemed able to extract genetic information. As interesting as these questions were in themselves, it seemed to me that the Neanderthal bone fragment held the promise of an even larger prize. Neanderthals are the closest extinct relative of contemporary humans. If we could study their DNA, we would undoubtedly find that their genes were very similar to ours. Some years earlier, my group had sequenced a large number of DNA fragments from the chimpanzee genome and had shown that in DNA sequences we shared with the chimpanzees, only a bit over 1% of the nucleotides differed. Clearly, the Neanderthals must be much closer to us than that, but, and this is what was immensely exciting, among the few differences one would expect to find in the Neanderthal genome, there must be those that set us apart from all earlier forms of human forerunners, not just from the Neanderthals, but also from Turkana Boy, who lived some 1.6 million years ago, Lucy, some 3.2 million years ago, and Peking Man, more than half a million years ago. Those few differences must form the biological foundations of the radically new direction our lineage took with the emergence of modern humans, the advent of rapidly developing technology, of art in a form we today immediately recognize as art, and maybe of language and culture as we now know it. If we could study Neanderthal DNA, all this would be within our grasp. Wrapped in such dreams, or delusions of grandeur, I finally drifted off to sleep as the sun rose. The next day, Matthias and I both arrived late at the lab, after checking the DNA sequence from the night before to make sure we had not made any mistakes, we sat down and planned what to do next. It was one thing to get the sequence of one little piece of mtDNA that looked interesting from the Neanderthal fossil, but it would be quite another to convince ourselves, let alone the rest of the world, that it was mtDNA from an individual who lived, in this particular case, some 40,000 years ago. My own work over the previous 12 years made our next step fairly clear. First, we needed to repeat the experiment, not just the last step, but all the steps, beginning with a new piece of the bone, in order to show that the sequence we had obtained was not some fluke derived from a badly damaged and modified modern DNA molecule in the bone. Second, we needed to extend the sequence of mtDNA we had obtained by retrieving overlapping DNA fragments from the bone extract. This would enable us to reconstruct a longer mtDNA sequence, with which we could begin to estimate just how different the mtDNA of Neanderthals was from that of humans today. And then a third step was necessary. I myself had often suggested that extraordinary claims about DNA sequences from ancient bones require extraordinary evidence, namely repetition of the results in another lab. an unusual step in a typically competitive scientific field. The claim that we had retrieved Neanderthal DNA would certainly be considered extraordinary. To exclude unknown sources of error in our lab, we needed to share some of the precious bone material with an independent lab and hope that it could manage to repeat our result. All of this I discussed with Matthias and Rolf. We laid out plans for the work and swore one another to absolute secrecy outside our research groups. We wanted no attention until we were sure that what we had was the real thing. Matthias got to work at once. Having spent almost 3 years on mostly fruitless attempts to extract DNA from Egyptian mummies, he was energized by the prospect of success. Rolf seemed frustrated over having to return to Bonn, where he could do nothing but eagerly await word of our results. I tried to concentrate on my other projects, but it was hard to take my mind off what Matthias was doing. What Matthias needed to do was not all that easy. We were dealing, after all, with something other than the intact and pristine DNA that comes from a blood sample drawn from a living person. The neat and tidy double-stranded helical DNA molecule in the textbooks, with its nucleotides A, T, G, and C attached in complementary pairs, adenine with thymine, guanine with cytosine, to the two sugar phosphate backbones, is not a static chemical structure when stored in the nuclei and mitochondria of our cells. Rather, DNA continually suffers chemical damage, which is recognized and repaired by intricate mechanisms. In addition, DNA molecules are extremely long. Each of the 23 pairs of chromosomes in the nucleus comprises one enormous DNA molecule. The total length of one set of 23 chromosomes adds up to about 3.2 billion nucleotide pairs. Since the nucleus has two copies of the genome, each copy stored on one set of 23 chromosomes, of which we inherit one from our mother and one from our father, it contains about 6.4 billion nucleotide pairs. By comparison, the mitochondrial DNA is tiny, with a little over 16,500 nucleotide pairs. But given that the mtDNA we had was ancient, the challenge involved in sequencing it was great. The most common type of damage that occurs spontaneously in DNA molecules, whether nuclear DNA or mtDNA, is the loss of a chemical component, an amino group, from the cytosine nucleotide, C, turning it into a nucleotide that does not naturally occur in DNA, called uracil, abbreviated U. There are enzyme systems in the cells that remove these U's and replace them with the correct nucleotide, C. The discarded U's end up as cellular garbage, and from analyses of damaged nucleotides excreted in our urine, it has been calculated that about 10,000 C's per cell morph into U's each day, only to be removed and then replaced. And this is just one of several types of chemical assaults our genome suffers. For example, nucleotides are lost, creating empty sites that quickly lead to breakage of the strands in the DNA molecules. Working against this are enzymes that fill in such missing nucleotides before a break can occur. If a break does occur, other enzymes join the DNA molecules back together. In fact, the genomes in our cells would not remain intact for even an hour if these repair systems were not there to maintain them. These repair systems, of course, require energy to work. When we die, we stop breathing. The cells in our body then run out of oxygen, and as a consequence, their energy runs out. This stops the repair of DNA, and various sorts of damage rapidly accumulate. In addition to the spontaneous chemical damage that continually occurs in living cells, there are forms of damage that occur after death, once the cells start to decompose. One of the crucial functions of living cells is to maintain compartments, where enzymes and other substances are kept separate from one another. Some of these compartments contain enzymes that can cut DNA strands and are necessary for certain types of repair. Other compartments contain enzymes that break down DNA from various microorganisms that the cell may encounter and engulf. Once an organism dies and runs out of energy, the compartment membranes deteriorate, and these enzymes leak out and begin degrading DNA in an uncontrolled way. Within hours and sometimes days after death, The DNA strands in our body are cut into smaller and smaller pieces, while various other forms of damage accumulate. At the same time, bacteria that live in our intestines and lungs start growing uncontrollably when our body fails to maintain the barriers that normally contain them. Together, these processes will eventually dissolve the genetic information stored in our DNA. The information that once allowed our body to form, be maintained, and function. When that process is complete, the last trace of our biological uniqueness is gone. In a sense, our physical death is then complete. However, nearly each one of the trillions of cells in our body contains the entire complement of our DNA. Thus, even if the DNA in some cells in some remote corner of our body evades complete decomposition, some trace of our genetic makeup will survive. For example, the enzymatic processes that degrade and modify the DNA require water to work. If some parts of our body dry out before the degradation of the DNA has run its course, these processes will stop, and fragments of our DNA may survive for a longer time. This occurs, for example, when a body is deposited in a dry place where it becomes mummified. Such whole-body desiccation may occur accidentally, owing to the environment in which the body happens to end up, or it may be deliberately practiced. As is commonly known, ritual mummification of the dead was often performed in ancient Egypt, where the bodies of hundreds of thousands of people who lived between about 5,000 and 1,500 years ago were mummified to provide post-mortem abodes for their souls. Even when mummification does not occur, some parts of the body, such as the bones and teeth, may survive long after burial. These hard tissues contain cells responsible for tasks such as forming new bone when a bone is broken that are embedded in microscopically small holes. When these bone cells die, their DNA may leak out and become bound to the mineral component of the bone, where it may be shielded from further enzymatic attack. Thus, with luck, some DNA may survive the onslaught of degradation and damage that occurs in the immediate aftermath of death. But even when some DNA survives the bodily chaos that follows death, other processes will continue to degrade our genetic information, albeit at a slower rate. For example, the continuous flow of background radiation that hits Earth from space creates reactive molecules that modify and break DNA. Furthermore, processes that require water, such as the loss of amino groups from the nucleotide C, resulting in U nucleotides, continue even when DNA is preserved under relatively dry conditions. This is because DNA has such an affinity for water that even in dry environments, water molecules are almost always bound to the grooves between the two DNA strands, allowing spontaneous water-dependent chemical reactions to occur. The loss of the amino group, or deanimation, of the nucleotide C is one of the fastest of these processes, and it will destabilize the DNA so that its strands eventually break. These and other processes, most still unknown, keep chipping away at our DNA even when it has survived the havoc that death itself causes in our cells. Although the rate of despoliation will depend on many circumstances, such as temperature, acidity, and more, it is clear that even under favorable conditions, ultimately even the last pieces of information from the genetic program that made a person possible will eventually be destroyed. It seemed that in the Neanderthal bone my colleagues and I had analyzed, all these processes had not yet fully completed their destructive task after 40,000 years. Matthias had retrieved the sequence of a piece of mtDNA 61 nucleotides long. To do so, he had to make many copies of this piece of DNA, which involved a process called the polymerase chain reaction, PCR. In his attempt to confirm our findings, he started by repeating his PCR experiment exactly as he had done it the first time. This experiment involves using two short synthetic pieces of DNA called primers, which were designed to bind to two places in the mtDNA, 61 nucleotide pairs apart. These primers are mixed with a tiny amount of the DNA extracted from the bone and an enzyme called DNA polymerase that can synthesize new DNA strands starting and ending with the primers. The mixture is heated to allow the two DNA strands to come apart so that the primers can find and bind to their target sequences. When the mixture is cooled via pairings of A's with T's and G's with C's, the enzyme will then use the primers bound to the DNA strands as starting points to synthesize two new strands, duplicating the two original strands from the bone, so that these two original strands become four strands. This amplification process is repeated to produce eight strands, then again to produce 16, then 32, and so on, for a total of 30 or 40 rounds of duplication. The PCR, a simple yet elegant technique invented by the maverick scientist Carrie Mullis in 1983, is extremely powerful. From a single DNA fragment, one can, in principle, obtain about a trillion copies after 40 cycles. This is what made our work possible. So, in my opinion, Mullis certainly deserved the Nobel Prize in Chemistry that he was awarded in 1993. However, the PCR's exquisite sensitivity also made our work difficult. In an extract from an ancient bone, which may contain very few surviving ancient DNA molecules or none at all, there might be one or more molecules of modern human DNA that have contaminated the experiment from the chemicals used, from the lab's plasticware, or from airborne dust. Dust particles in rooms where humans live or work are, to a large extent, human skin fragments, which contain cells full of DNA. Alternatively, human DNA might have contaminated the sample when a person handled it, say in a museum or at an excavation. It was with these concerns in mind that we chose to study the sequence of the most variable part of the Neanderthal mtDNA. Since many humans differ from one another in that particular section, we could at least tell whether more than one human had contributed DNA to our experiment and thus be warned that something was amiss. This is why we were so excited about finding a DNA sequence with changes never before seen in any human. Had the sequence looked like that of a living human, we would have had no way of determining whether it meant, on the one hand, that the Neanderthal was indeed identical in mtDNA to some people today, or, on the other, that we were just looking at a modern mtDNA fragment that had made its way into our experiments from some insidious source, such as a speck of dust. By this time, I was all too acquainted with the fact of contamination. I had been working for more than 12 years on the extraction and analysis of ancient DNA from such extinct mammals as cave bears, woolly mammoths, and ground sloths. After a string of frustrating results, I detected human mtDNA in almost all the animal bones I analyzed with the PCR. I spent a great deal of time thinking about and devising ways to minimize contamination. Thus, Matthias performed all extractions and other experiments right up to the first temperature cycle of the PCR in a small lab that was kept meticulously clean and absolutely separate from the rest of our laboratory. Once the ancient DNA, the primers, and the other components necessary for the PCR had been placed together in a tube, the tube was sealed, and the temperature cycles and all subsequent experiments were performed in the regular laboratory. In the clean lab, all surfaces were washed with bleach once a week, and every night the lab was irradiated with UV light to destroy any dust-borne DNA. Matthias entered the clean lab through an antechamber, where he and others working there donned protective gowns, face shields, hairnets, and sterile gloves. All reagents and instruments were delivered directly to the clean lab. Nothing was allowed into it from other parts of the institute. Matthias and his colleagues had to start their workday in the clean lab instead of in other parts of our laboratory, where large amounts of DNA were being analyzed. Once they had entered any such lab, they were banned from the clean lab for the rest of the day. To put it mildly, I was paranoid about DNA contamination, and I felt I had good reason to be. Even so, in Matthias's initial experiments, we had seen evidence of some human contamination of the bone. After using the PCR to amplify a piece of mtDNA from the bone, he had cloned the resulting batch of supposedly identical DNA copies in bacteria. He did this in order to see whether more than one type of mtDNA sequence might exist among the cloned molecules. Each bacterium will take up just one 61-nucleotide molecule joined to a carrier molecule called a plasmid, and grow up to a clone of millions of bacteria, where each carries copies of the 61-nucleotide molecule the first bacterium took up. So we were able to get an overview of whatever different DNA sequences existed in the population of molecules by sequencing a number of the clones. In Matthias's earliest experiment, we saw 17 cloned molecules that were similar or identical to one another, while different from the 2,000-plus modern human mtDNAs we were using for comparison. But we also saw one that was identical to a sequence seen in some humans today. This clearly showed the presence of contamination, perhaps from museum curators or others who had handled the bone over the 140 years since its discovery. So the first thing Matthias did in his attempt to reproduce our original result was to repeat the PCR and the cloning. This time he found 10 clones with the unique sequence that had excited us so much, and two that looked like they could have come from any modern person. He then went back to the bone and made another extract, did the PCR and cloning again, and got 10 clones of the interesting type and four that looked like mtDNA from present-day humans. Now we were satisfied. Our original result had passed the first tests. We could repeat them and see the same unusual DNA sequence each time. Matthias next started to walk along the mtDNA, using other primers designed to amplify fragments that overlapped a part of the first fragment but extended further into other regions of the mtDNA. See figure 1.2. Once again, we observed that some of the sequences of those fragments had nucleotide changes never seen in contemporary humans. Over the next few months, Matthias amplified 13 different DNA fragments of different sizes, each at least twice. The interpretation of the sequences was complicated by the fact that any one DNA molecule can carry mutations that can be due to various causes: ancient chemical modifications, sequencing errors, or even rare but natural variation that may exist among the mtDNA molecules found within a cell of an individual. Therefore, we used a strategy I had worked out previously for ancient animal DNA. Again, see figure 1.2. For each position in each experiment, we took as authentic the so-called consensus nucleotide. That is, the nucleotide, A, T, G, or C, carried in that position by most of the molecules we examined. We also required that each position be identical in at least two independent experiments, since a PCR might, in an extreme case, have started from a single DNA strand, in which case all the clones, due to some error in the first PCR cycle or to some chemical modification in that particular DNA strand, would carry the same nucleotide in the same position. If two PCRs differed with regard to even a single position, we repeated the PCR a third time to see which of the two nucleotides was reproducible. Matthias eventually used 123 clone DNA molecules to puzzle together a sequence of 379 nucleotides of the most variable part of the mtDNA. According to the criteria we had settled on, this was the DNA sequence that this Neanderthal carried when he or she was alive. Once we had this longer sequence, we could begin the exciting work of comparing it with the variations seen in present-day humans. At this point, we compared our 379 nucleotide Neanderthal mtDNA sequence to the corresponding mtDNA sequences from 2,051 present-day humans from all around the world. On average, 28 of the positions differed between the Neanderthal and a contemporary person, whereas people alive today carry an average of only 7 differences from one another. The Neanderthal mtDNA was 4 times as different. We then looked for any indication that the Neanderthal mtDNA was more like the mtDNA found in modern Europeans. One might well expect to find this, since Neanderthals evolved and lived in Europe and Western Asia. Indeed, some paleontologists believe that Neanderthals are among the ancestors of today's Europeans. We compared the Neanderthal mtDNA with that of 510 Europeans and discovered that it carried, on average, 28 differences. We then compared it with mtDNA from 478 Africans and 494 Asians. The average number of differences from the mtDNAs of these people was also 28. This meant that, on average, European mtDNAs were no more similar to the Neanderthal mtDNA than were mtDNAs from modern-day Africans and Asians. But maybe Neanderthal mtDNAs were similar to mtDNAs found in just some Europeans, as one would expect if Neanderthals had contributed some mtDNA to Europeans. We checked this and found that the Europeans in our sample whose mtDNAs were most like that of the Neanderthal showed 23 differences. The Africans and Asians closest to the Neanderthal carried 22 and 23 respectively. In short, we observed not only that the Neanderthal mtDNA seemed very different from the mtDNAs of modern humans worldwide, but also that there was no indication of any special relationship between the Neanderthal mtDNA and any subset of European mtDNAs alive today. However, just counting differences is not enough to reconstruct the evolutionary history of a piece of DNA. The differences found between DNA sequences represent mutations that occurred in the past. But some types of mutations are more frequent than others, and some positions in DNA sequences are more prone to mutate than others. At such positions, more than one mutation, especially the types that happen more frequently, may have occurred in the history of a DNA sequence. Therefore, to estimate the history of this particular piece of mtDNA, we needed to apply models for how we believed it had mutated and evolved, bearing in mind that certain positions might have mutated more than once, thus obscuring previous mutations. The result of such a reconstruction is depicted as a tree, in which a DNA sequence on the tip of a branch links back to a common ancestral DNA sequence. These ancestral sequences are depicted as the points where branches join on the tree. See Figure 1.3. When we did such a tree reconstruction, we saw that the mtDNAs of all humans alive today trace their ancestry back to one common mtDNA ancestor. This finding, which was already known from Alan Wilson's work in the 1980s, is in fact expected for mtDNA, since each of us carries only a single type and cannot exchange pieces of it with other mtDNA molecules in the population. Since mtDNA is passed on only by mothers, the mtDNA lineage of a woman will die out if she has no female descendants. So, in each generation, some mtDNA lineages vanish. Therefore, there must once have existed a woman, the so-called mitochondrial Eve, who carried an mtDNA lineage that would turn out to be the ancestor of all human mtDNAs today, simply because all other lineages since that time have been lost purely by chance. According to our models, however, the Neanderthal mtDNA did not trace back to this mitochondrial Eve, but went further back, before it shared an ancestor with the mtDNAs of humans alive today. This finding was immensely exciting. It proved beyond any doubt that we had recovered a piece of Neanderthal DNA, and it showed, at least with respect to their mtDNA, that the Neanderthals were profoundly different from us. My colleagues and I also used the models to estimate how long ago the Neanderthal mtDNA shared an ancestor with current human mtDNAs. The number of differences between the two types of mtDNA is an indication of how long they have been transmitted through generations independently of each other. The mutation rates of widely separated species, mice and monkeys, say, will differ, but among closely related species, such as humans, Neanderthals, and the great apes, they have been constant enough to allow scientists to estimate, based on the differences observed, when two DNA sequences last shared an ancestor. Using the models for how fast different types of mutations occur in mtDNA, we estimated that the mtDNA ancestor common to all humans alive today, the mitochondrial Eve, lived between 100,000 and 200,000 years ago, as Alan Wilson and his team had found. However, the ancestor that the Neanderthal mtDNA shared with human mtDNAs lived about 500,000 years ago. That is, she was three or four times as ancient as the mitochondrial Eve, from whom all present-day human mtDNAs are descended. This was amazing stuff. I was now fully convinced that we had recovered Neanderthal DNA and that it was very different from the DNA of modern humans. However, before publishing our findings, we needed to overcome the last hurdle. We needed to find an independent laboratory that could repeat what we had done. Such a lab would not need to determine the entire 379-nucleotide mtDNA sequence, but it would have to retrieve one of the regions that carried one or more substitutions, setting Neanderthals apart from humans today. This would show that the DNA sequence we had determined really existed in the bone and wasn't some strange and unknown sequence perhaps floating around in our laboratory. But to whom could we turn? This was a delicate issue. Although many labs would undoubtedly want to participate in such a potentially high-profile project, there was the risk that if we chose one that had not worked as intensely as we had on minimizing contamination and addressing all the other problems associated with ancient DNA, it might fail to successfully extract and amplify a relevant sequence. If that happened, our results would be deemed irreproducible and thus unpublishable. I knew that no one had spent as much time and effort on this sort of work as we had, but we eventually settled on the laboratory of Mark Stoneking, a population geneticist at Penn State University. Mark had been a graduate student and then a postdoc with Alan Wilson at Berkeley, and I knew him from my time spent as a postdoc there in the late 1980s. He was one of the people behind the discovery of the mitochondrial Eve, and one of the architects of the out-of-Africa hypothesis of modern human origins, the idea that modern humans originated in Africa some 100,000 to 200,000 years ago, then spread around the world and replaced all earlier forms of humans, such as the Neanderthals in Europe, without admixture. I respected his judgment and integrity and knew him to be an easygoing person. Moreover, one of his graduate students, Anne Stone, had spent the 1992-1993 academic year in our laboratory. Anne, a serious-minded and ambitious scientist, had worked with us on the retrieval of mtDNA from some Native American skeletal remains, so she was familiar with our techniques. I felt that if anyone could repeat what we had done, she could. I contacted Mark. As expected, he and Anne were excited about trying this. So we parted with one of the last pieces of bone that Ralph had given us. We told Anne and Mark which part of the mtDNA they should try to amplify so that they would have the best chance of hitting one of the positions in the mtDNA sequence that carried a mutation typical of our Neanderthal sequence. But we sent them no primers or other reagents, just a piece of bone that had been kept in a sealed tube since its trip from Bonn. This precaution minimized any chance that a contaminant might pass from our lab to theirs. We also did not tell them what positions were typical of Neanderthal mtDNA, not because I didn't trust them, but because I wanted to be able to say we had done everything we could to avoid even an unconscious bias. In short, Anne would have to synthesize the primers and do everything independently of us without knowing exactly what result we expected. Once we'd sent the bone off by FedEx, we just had to wait. Generally, these sorts of experiments take longer than expected. A company fails to deliver primers in the promised time, a reagent you test for contamination turns out to have human DNA in it, a technician falls sick the day he is to run the sequencing machine with the crucial sample. We waited for what seemed like an eternity for Anne to call from Pennsylvania. And then one night she did call. The tone of her voice immediately told me she was not happy. She had cloned 15 amplified DNA molecules from the region of interest, and they all looked like any person's today, in fact, like my own or Anne's mtDNA. This was a crushing defeat. What did it mean? Had we amplified some freak mtDNA? I could not believe that was the case. If it was from some unknown animal, it would not be as close to human mtDNA as it was. Yet, it could hardly be mtDNA from some unusual human if it was roughly 4 times as different as all the human mtDNAs that had been studied. There was always the possibility that the sequence we had come up with was created by some chemical modification of the ancient DNA that consistently attacked the same positions in the sequence. However, such a modified mtDNA sequence would be expected to look like a human sequence with extra changes added by this unknown chemical process, rather than like a sequence that had branched off the human lineage in the past. And even then, why wouldn't Anne find the same sequence we did? The only plausible explanation seemed to be that Anne had more contamination in her experiments than we did. So much so that it outnumbered the rare Neanderthal molecules. What could we do? We could hardly go back to Rolf and ask him for another piece of the valuable fossil on the chance that the next experiment would be more successful than the first. Perhaps even if Anne's experiments had more contamination than ours did, she could sequence thousands of mtDNA molecules from her piece of bone and thereby find some rare ones that looked like ours. But in the meantime, we had done experiments to estimate the number of Neanderthal mtDNA molecules in the Neanderthal bone extracts we had used to start our PCRs. As it turned out, there were about 50. By comparison, a source of contamination such as a dust particle might contain tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands of mtDNA molecules. So any such fishing expedition was very likely to fail. I discussed this conundrum at length, not only with Matthias, but in our weekly lab meetings with the subgroup of my lab working on ancient DNA. Throughout my career, I have found these extensive discussions with scientists working in my lab to be very useful. Indeed, I think they have been crucial to whatever successes we have had. In such discussions, ideas that would never occur to people focusing solely on their own work are often hatched. Moreover, scientists without a personal stake in a project's outcome provide a reality check, since they are free of the wishful thinking all too common among those who are working on a project they love and on which their scientific future may depend. Often my role in these discussions is to moderate and select the ideas that seem promising enough to pursue. Once again, our meeting bore fruit, and we came up with a plan. Anne would be asked to make primers that would not be a perfect match to modern DNA. Instead, the final nucleotide on their tips would match a nucleotide uniquely seen in our putative Neanderthal sequence. Such primers would not, or only very weakly, initiate amplification from modern human mtDNA, and thus would favor the amplification of Neanderthal-like mtDNAs. We discussed this plan thoroughly, especially the crucial point of whether Anne's effort could be considered an independent replication of our finding if she used information from our sequence to make the primers. Obviously, it would have been more aesthetically pleasing if Anne had been able to come up with the same sequence that we did without any prior knowledge of the sequence. However, we could tell her to synthesize Neanderthal-specific primers that would bracket 2 other positions that also carried unique nucleotides. And we would not tell her where or how many of those positions there were. If she found the same unique nucleotide changes that we had, then we would all be convinced that such molecules were indeed native to the bone itself. After much further discussion, we agreed that this was a legitimate way forward. We transmitted the necessary information to Anne. She ordered the new primers. We waited. By now, it was mid-December, and Anne had told us earlier that she planned to fly to North Carolina to visit her parents over Christmas. I obviously could not tell her to cancel, much as I wished she would. Finally, after almost 2 weeks, the phone rang. Anne had sequenced 5 molecules from her new PCR products. All of them contained the 2 substitutions we had seen in our Neanderthal sequence, substitutions that are rare or absent in modern humans. This was an enormous relief. I felt we all deserved a Christmas break. We called Rolf in Bonn to relay the good news. As I'd often done during my years in Munich, I celebrated New Year by taking a skiing trip with some wildlife biologists to remote valleys in the Alps on the Austrian border. This time, while skiing up the spectacular valleys, I could not refrain from formulating the paper that would describe the first DNA sequence from a Neanderthal. To me, what we were about to describe was even more spectacular than the steep and snowy landscape surrounding me. Matthias and I met up again in the lab after Christmas vacations and sat down to write our paper. One major question was where to send it. Nature, the British journal, and its American counterpart Science enjoy the most prestige and visibility in the scientific community and in the general media, and either would have been an obvious choice. But they both impose strict length limits on manuscripts, and I wanted to explain all the details of what we had done, not only to convince the world that we had the real thing, but also to promote our painstaking methods of extracting and analyzing ancient DNA. In addition, I had become disenchanted with both journals because of their tendency to publish flashy ancient DNA results that did not meet the scientific criteria our group considered necessary. They often seemed more interested in publishing papers that would give them coverage in the New York Times and other major media outlets than in making sure the results were sound and likely to hold up. I discussed all this with Thomas Lindahl, a Swedish-born scientist at the Imperial Cancer Research Fund Laboratory in London. Thomas, a preeminent expert in DNA damage, is soft-spoken, yet not one to shy away from controversy when he knows he's right. He has been something of a mentor to me since 1985, when I spent 6 weeks in his laboratory studying chemical damage in ancient DNA. Thomas suggested we send the paper to Cell, a highly respected and influential journal that specializes in molecular and cell biology. Publication there would send a signal to the community that the sequencing of ancient DNA was solid molecular biology, and not just about the production of sexy but questionable results. Moreover, Cell allowed long articles. Thomas called its celebrated editor Benjamin Lewin to gauge his interest, since such a manuscript was somewhat outside Cell's usual scope. Lewin told us to submit it, and he would send it out for the usual peer review. This was great news. We now had sufficient space in which to describe all our experiments and present all the arguments for why we were convinced we had genuine Neanderthal DNA. Today, I still consider this paper to be one of my best. In addition to describing the painstaking way in which we had reconstructed the mtDNA sequence and why we considered it genuine, it laid out the evidence that our mtDNA sequence fell outside the range of variation seen today, and the implication that the Neanderthals had not contributed mtDNA to modern humans. These conclusions were compatible with the out-of-Africa model of human evolution that Alan Wilson, Mark Stone King, and others had proposed. As my colleagues and I said in our paper, the Neanderthal mtDNA sequence thus supports a scenario in which modern humans arose recently in Africa as a distinct species and replaced Neanderthals with little or no interbreeding. We also tried to describe all the caveats we could think of. In particular, we pointed out that mtDNA offers only a limited view of the genetic history of a species. Because it is transmitted only from mothers to offspring, it reflects exclusively the female side of history. Therefore, if Neanderthals interbred with modern humans, we would detect it only if females crossed over between the two groups. This need not have been the case. In more recent human history, when human groups that differ in social status have met and interacted, they almost always had sex with one another and produced offspring. But this generally occurred in a biased way with respect to what males and females do. In other words, the partner from the socially dominant group was most often male, and the offspring of these unions tended to remain in their mother's group. Of course, we do not know if such a pattern was typical of modern humans when they came to Europe and met Neanderthals some 35,000 years ago. And we do not even know if modern humans were socially dominant in any sense that would be comparable to what we see among human groups today. But it is clear that looking only at the female side of inheritance tells us only half the story of what happened. Another even more important limitation of mtDNA stems from the way it is inherited. As noted, an individual's mtDNA does not exchange bits and pieces with another individual's mtDNA. Furthermore, if a woman has only sons, her mtDNA will become extinct. Because chance plays such a strong role in the history of mtDNA, even if some had passed from Neanderthals to early modern humans in Europe at some point between 35,000 and 30,000 years ago, it may well have disappeared. This limitation does not exist for the chromosomes in the cell nucleus. Recall that they exist in pairs in every individual, with one chromosome in the pair coming from the mother and the other coming from the father. When sperm or egg cells are formed in an individual, the chromosomes break and rejoin in an intricate dance that results in pieces being exchanged between them. Therefore, if we are able to study several parts of an individual's nuclear genome, we would get several different versions of the genetic history of a group. For example, even if, in some parts, the variants perhaps contributed by Neanderthals were lost, this would probably not be the case for all parts. Therefore, by looking at many parts of the nuclear genome, one arrives at a picture of human history that is much less influenced by chance. For this reason, we concluded in our paper that our results do not rule out the possibility that Neanderthals contributed other genes to modern humans. However, given the evidence at hand, we clearly favored the out-of-Africa hypothesis. Our paper was peer-reviewed and accepted for publication by Cell after only minor revisions. As is typical for all top journals, the editors at Cell insisted that we not talk about our results before publication in the July 11th issue. They prepared a press release, and I flew to the press conference they organized in London for the day of the publication. It was my first press conference, and the first time I'd ever found myself at the center of such intense media attention. Much to my surprise, I enjoyed trying to get across the essence of our work, doing my best to describe both our conclusions and the caveats involved. It was not that easy, because our data had direct implications for a pitched battle that had been raging in the field of anthropology for over 10 years. This battle had been initiated by the out-of-Africa hypothesis, which Alan Wilson and his colleagues had proposed, based largely on the patterns of present-day human mtDNA variation. Initially, the idea had been met with ridicule and hostility by the paleontological community. Almost all paleontologists at the time subscribed to the so-called multi-regional model for the origin of modern humans, holding that modern humans evolved on several continents more or less independently from Homo erectus. They saw a deep history dividing current groups of humans. The ancestors of current Europeans, for instance, were thought to be the Neanderthals and perhaps earlier European hominins. The ancestors of current Asians were thought to be other archaic forms in Asia, going back to Peking man. However, a growing number of respected paleontologists, foremost among them Chris Stringer at the Natural History Museum in London, now viewed the out-of-Africa model of modern human origins as the best fit to both the fossil record and the archaeological evidence. Chris had been invited by Cell to the press conference, where he announced that our retrieval of Neanderthal DNA was, to paleontology, what the lunar landing had been to space exploration. I was, of course, pleased, though not surprised by his praise. I was even more pleased when the other side, the multi-regionalists, had good things to say, at least about the technical aspects of our work, particularly when the most vociferous and pugnacious of them, Milford Wolpoff of the University of Michigan, declared in a commentary in Science that, if anyone would be able to do this, it would be Svante. All in all, I was stunned by the attention our paper received. It was reported on the first page of many major newspapers and on radio and TV news shows worldwide. In the week after the paper appeared, I spent most of my time on the phone with journalists. I had worked on ancient DNA since 1984 and had gradually realized that it must in principle be possible to recover Neanderthal DNA. And 9 months had now passed since Matthias called and awakened me to say he saw a DNA sequence that did not look human come out of one of our sequencing machines. So I'd had time to get used to the idea, and unlike most of the rest of the world, was not shaken by our achievement. Once the media frenzy had died down, though, I felt the need for some perspective. I wanted to reflect on the years that had led up to this discovery, and to think about where I would go next.